But if you're doing it for credit, there's a charge involved with it because it has to be that way. I think you understand that. But it would be foolish to pay out money for an education and then not really have your heart in it. Why bother to get an education, a Christian education? If you're not going to really do something with it. You're coming over here on Thursday night and listening to this man lecture every Thursday night. But you have some character about you. You take advantage of this and use it for your own enhancement of your life. And really build some character and follow some instructions that you've been given, and it would help your life. I don't know, but all of us could probably enhance our life in some way or another, and that's why you're here in this class. I've said it before, I believe, but I have thought of it all my life. I've always kind of wanted to go away to some finishing school. I never did. You know, like an airline stewardess. They go away to some training somewhere. Have you ever been on an airplane? These girls, our men, they treat you just absolutely. They smile when you ask for it. Oh, yes, I'll be more than glad to get this for you. And it's never, I am not trying to fool with you. No, it's just, they've been trained to be sweet and kind and loving and thoughtful and know all the answers. I thought to myself, it would be such a good thing if we could have a course somewhere. Somebody could start up a school, a finishing school for Baptist preachers, so that they could learn how to be cordial and kind and loving and thoughtful and considerate and helpful to all of those around about. Maybe it's just something that God has to do. I don't know, but that's what I get out of that verse. I'm going to go to verse 17. A friend loveth at all times, and a brother is born for adversity. Would you underscore that word, at all times? Friends. Friends are people who love you all the time. That's a lasting friendship. Could I tell you, can I lean back all right now? I'm not going to be out of breath. Class, don't take me wrong, but you probably, in your lifetime, will make that many friends. I mean, that many lifelong friends. You may have some friends that are friendly, but to have some golden friends, somebody you could call at 3 o'clock in the morning and say, I need you to help me right now. And that they'd drop everything that they were doing, sleeping or whatever, and come to your side to help you.
Amen.
You might have that many friends in all of your life. You don't find those people. They're not that many around. They're fair weather friends. But that's good to have some, but it's nice to have some gold friends. And the old friends usually are your gold friends. Your new friends are silver. Silver friends are good, but golden friends, they're better. You understand what I mean? You take somebody who's been your friend for 10, 15, 20 years, maybe 30. Maybe they were your dad and mother's friend, and you have assumed their friendship because of the friendship with your mother and dad. Maybe your mother and dad have passed away, but their friends are still your friends. Now those are old, genuine friends that'll help you down through your life. He said, I don't need any friends. That is because you're an idiot. You're an idiot. You really are. He said, well, I got a friend in Jesus. You know why you say that? Because you're super spiritual. You really are just more super spiritual jerk. Sure, we got a friend in Jesus. Sure, he's better than any friend there is in the world. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about a friend. This side of heaven in this kind of flesh. That is true friend. You can trust it. You could go to that person and confide in them a problem and feel like they would not tell another living soul. You don't find those people like that. In the Bible, you have Abraham and his nephew Lot. When Lot got into trouble, it was his friend and Uncle Abe that came to his aid. You understand that? You take Jonathan and David. They bonded themselves together in a covenant to look after each other and to be kind to each other's family. Here comes Bezalel, 80 years old, hardly can get around. David's been chased out of Jerusalem by his son Absalom. He's over on the other side of Jordan. He's coming back now on a ferry boat, that's what the Bible said, across the river. And who greets him but Barzilla, 80-year-old man. And David said, what are you doing here, Barzilla? Well, I brought this and this and this and this. Brought all this food, and I brought all these provisions, and I brought these drinks, and I brought all this stuff for you to help you and encourage you. That's a friend. And he said, well, I'd like to go with you. And then, no, David said, you don't need to do that. You just go back and live with your family and finish out your days. I love you. Well, you can take, there's a black man in the Bible. His name was Ebed-Melech. And they had put Jeremiah down in the dungeon. And when he got into that dungeon, he sunk into the muck and the mire that was in the bottom of that dungeon. They did not feed him half at all enough. So this man, Ebed-Melech, went to the king and said, that man is... He must have been a southern Negro, where he said he locked to die. That's what he said. Those are four. He's about locked to die down there in that prison. So the king said, all right, go and get him out. Take 30 men and take some old ropes. Take some ropes and some old cloth rags and have Jeremiah put those rags under his armpits, under the ropes that there, and 30 men pull him up out of that dungeon. But you know, Jeremiah never forgot that fellow. He mentions him over again, how that he really saved his life. Sometimes you'll see in the Bible people like Paul and like this Philemon that he Paul had led him to the Lord. He was a jailbird. And he led him to the Lord. And then he wrote back to his master, who he was really a runaway slave from, and told him, and he knew his master, and was a Christian man, and said, I'd like to have you receive, I'd like to have you consider taking Philemon back again. And if he's cost you anything, charge it to my account. Now, that's a real friend. I mean, there's Barnabas and there's Paul. When Paul got converted, when he was converted to Damascus, when he went back to Jerusalem, none of those people there, none of the disciples would trust him because he caused so much trouble. But good old Barnabas. Barnabas means son of consolation. And he said, oh, fellas, you don't realize that this man's been genuinely saved. And he's preaching Jesus Christ up and down the country. And you can trust him. He's going to be all right. And they took him in. And Paul got his right hand of fellowship into that church because of Barnabas, somebody that cared. There was Epaphroditus, who labored so hard for the Lord that he become sick and serving God. And Paul really went to bat for him to encourage him. But I want to just say to you, if you have a friend, Paul, be loyal to that friend. And like I said, you're not going to maybe have more than a dozen friends, but be loyal to those friends. Friends are so important. They'll stick with you through thick and thin in your life. And he said in our text that there is a brother for our adversity. For the day of adversity, when you're really, really, really up against it, when you really are in a peck of trouble, there is a Christian brother for that day of adversity, a brother that will help you. I don't know if you've ever been, Mona, have you ever been in deep, deep trouble? And somebody came, a friend, and just kind of lifted the load. You can understand what I'm saying about that. That's loyal friends. Boys, I trust that you'll do that. Girls, I trust you do that. Be loyal to your friends. That's something I have practiced, and I'm not saying I'm wonderful, but I'm loyal to my friends, and they know I'm loyal to my friends. A friend loveth at all times. That's what it says. Friends are really important. He that hath a friend must show himself friendly. Be honest and be charactered and be faithful. I don't know, but I would think myself now, Mona, Paul, I would think your best friend in this world would be Mona. And you would be Mona's best friend. And Donna, I would think that your husband would be your best friend.
Yes, yes.
You can understand that. And so on with Mark and Nikki. Now, the rest of you that are single, you need to find a friend. But I think it's not only wonderful to be married, but it's wonderful when you're married to your best friend.
Yes,
you really got something, boy. Something that'll help you. But then to make friends outside of that. I've told you this maybe many times, but your mother and dad, if they're still living, are the best friends you will ever have. Don't fall out with them. And Christian friends that you make, you'll have wonderful fellowship. But don't have fellowship with unsaved friends, because you'll get yourself messed up. But be faithful to your friends, and you'll never regret it. You never will. But those dirty-minded friends, those selfish friends, there are people, Mark, that would make friends with you, John Matthew, Brother Greg, there are people that make friends with you to use you. And when they got everything they want out of you, they'll trash you.
Yeah.
You've been around people like that?
Yep.
They'll trash you. After they've got sucked all the strength and the goodness out of your life, they'll drop you. Those are not friends. They have slipped you.
Amen.
But if you could just have, find yourself some godly good friends, you'll have a wonderful life. Our text said, a friend loveth at all times, and a brother is born for adversity. I'm sorry, time's up. I've had a good time teaching tonight, and I hope and pray that little by little, these cataracts and they mess my eyesight up, but I'm all right. I'll live till I die and then I'll get some new eyes. Worms chapter 17, verse 18. A man void of understanding striketh hands and becometh surety in the presence of his friend. I just want to say, first of all, this is not the first verse, but over and over and over and over again, God tells his people not to go surety for anything, anybody. I shouldn't say that. I believe I could correct that. That we're not to go surety, and particularly for a friend. I could see maybe going surety for your son or sister or brother, maybe. But even at that, there could run into some deep, dark, black waters in your life. But God warns us to help us to keep our friends. If a friend would ask you to go security for him for a loan, and try to hesitate to do so. If he defaults in his payments, then you have to pick up his payments with all the payments you have already. It may be a real hardship upon you, but sometimes when that occurs, that the people that couldn't make the payments will never make the payments. And they stick you with whatever the loan might be, and then they'll leave you because they're embarrassed, because they've done this to you. And probably the last time you'll have any real friendship with those friends. It isn't just exactly right. Could I tell you, as Christian workers, don't borrow money from a friend. If you're going to borrow money, borrow it from the bank or somebody else that isn't in your church family, because you're gonna, if you have a default, you're gonna perhaps hurt yourself, and you drop out of church because you can't face these other people, or they'll drop out because they can't really face you either. And I, several things that bothers me, and I said something last night, and I hope I didn't offend anybody, but I don't like to see our, I don't like to see our church members work in the same place with other church members, because you get so familiar at work, and especially if one gets fired or laid off and the other doesn't, or if you hired some church member to work for you and they didn't pan out and you had to fire them, you might as well say goodbye, because they're going to leave the church. I just can't hardly stand it when I see it. There's a couple of three people in our church right now that are working together, and a couple of them went to in partnership together, and I know sooner or later it will be curtains for one of those families. Familiarity breeds contempt. It kind of, when you get to know somebody real intimately, you can find their faults, and it isn't a good thing to do. You can make enemies by having somebody borrow money from you, or you borrowing money, or you going surety at the bank because they don't have credit. You sign your name with your credit, and because they couldn't keep up with their payments, they default, and it may hurt your credit, so you couldn't even do anything in the future. So I say we're Christians, and I'm talking to my class. I'm not talking to my Sunday school or my congregation. I'm talking to Christian workers who are going to be involved in the Lord's work. Don't take advantage of your friends. Don't use your friends. Or I should say, don't misuse your friends. If somebody was to ask you to borrow some money, the best thing to do would to say to them, now listen, I would rather not, but let me do this. I've got $25 or $20 or $50. I'd just like to give it to you.
Yeah, for sure.
And I could help you this little much in what you're trying to do, but I'd rather not get involved in this, and help them out the best you can. But you'll be a lot better off, and you'll probably keep your friendship going good. But I'd be careful. I don't even ask a friend to borrow money from you. Don't do that. You say, what are friends for? Well, friends are not to be taken advantage. If you do borrow money, pay it back when you told that person you was going to pay it back. Don't you say, well, I didn't get it together. Like, you get it together. If you have to borrow it from somebody else, you pay that debt, or else you lose what you're going to lose a friend. I tell you, that money, we're Christian people, and we try to keep a loose hand on our money from the standpoint of we're not putting the emphasis of life on money making.
Yeah.
And it's not the big thing before our eyes, but still it takes a lot of it to keep going. And you have to pay your rent or your payments, and you have to buy your groceries, and you just can't really do this for everybody. You could help somebody once in a while, but don't take advantage. If you do, like I say, make it for a short time next week. I mean, I'll have to have it by next Wednesday. And have a complete understanding before you just dish out your money. But I would think it'd be better for you to be willing to give it. And and not expect it back. We have people constantly come by the office and want us to buy their groceries, or buy a tank of gas, or pay their light bill or their gas bill, which should be $600 maybe. And we say, well, we just don't do that. Now, there may be other churches in town you might help you in that way, but we don't do that. What we do, if somebody is really hard up, we'll give you $10. And I know you say, well, what's $10? But let me ask you, Brother Paul, have you ever been to the place where $10 would mean a lot to you? You know, where $10 would buy some groceries?
I haven't been there, but yeah.
But you know what I mean?
Or
it would buy a 5-gallon can of kerosene that you could put in your furnace. Or it would be buy at least $10 of gas so you get to work. It's nothing much at all. But it's better than shutting them right out and saying, we're not going to give you anything. A lot of them say $5, $10, I forget it. But boy, I've seen the time when $10 would mean a lot. How about you, Greg? I've actually gone and picked up pop bottles and sold them because I needed the money to buy milk for the kids. But I you have to be careful about going surety. Write these scriptures down, and we're not reading them, but Proverbs 6, 1 through 4, Proverbs 11, 15, Proverbs 22, 26, 228 talks about not going surety, as well as the verse that we're studying right now. So be careful about money matters. Be careful about money matters. And don't be a jerk. It'd be better for you to go without than to not do right. I think this is the best advice I could give you, is to pay your own way through life. Don't be a deadbeat. Be honest. Keep the promises that you made. But you give somebody money, expecting never to have it returned. I told you this. About people coming want money. Well, sometimes we might give them $20 because of the circumstance. I probably even give them 50 at times. Oh, but Brother Green, we're going to bring it back. But I have never once in all of these 48 years that I have been at this church had anybody ever pay it back. They don't ever pay it back. Maybe they mean to, but they never do. And just don't hurt people by money matters. I recommended to you a book on how to win friends and influence people. Somebody said that they wrote a sequel, How to Skin Friends and Influential People. But that's not the way it works. If you want to keep yourself good friendship with people, just don't borrow money and be careful about going surety for somebody else. In chapter 17, verse 19, he loveth transgression that loveth strife, and he that exalteth his gate seeketh destruction. He that loveth iniquity or transgression, I'm about he that loves sin, and he that builds his gate to his house or mansion or whatever, it says here, talks about building it, exalting it, putting on a big front for your gate, your house or land or whatever, making it elaborate so folks would think that you're wealthy. And but in those days of these writings, gates kind of were important, but people would many times build gates around their fence and a gate around their house to impress their neighbors of how much money they had. But really, in those days, it was sort of a mark for robbers and vandals to get in. Because this guy has got this money to build this kind of a gate. He must have some money inside there. Some of them, I read, did my homework, that they would build their gates only 3 foot high. I mean, the actual door to it, you'd have to scooch down and get into the gate. They did that so robbers and other vandals could not ride their horses into their places to keep them, protect them from people looting and robbing and whatever. You remember when the king of Babylon, the reason I say in these days, you have to kind of think of their culture a little bit about the gates, that the king of Babylon, when he came in, I'm sure he didn't know who lived in town in Jerusalem, but it said that he destroyed all the people of wealth. Those wealthy homes were built in such a manner that they, when the Babylonians came, they destroyed them because they probably felt that they were leaders. They were salaried people. They were business people. But the poor homes, they didn't destroy them. I would think our lesson for today is sort of a lesson about two things. It's about sin. The first part of it says, he that loveth transgression loveth strife. He that loves sin. I want to ask you a question. You don't have to answer it. How much sin do you suppose that we ought to allow in our life? Do you love sin? Do you love transgressions? Well, if you love transgressions and you love sin, you're not through with sin. But when you get through with sin, you'll hate sin. You'll hate it in your life. You won't want to have sin in your life. You saw, Brother Green, everybody sins. But whenever a Christian sins, he hates it. I've never known anybody that was a Christian that was proud of the sin that they were committing. Because the Holy Spirit would surely be grieved in your heart if you did anything wrong. How much sin do you suppose you ought to tolerate in your life? How much sin do you suppose you ought to tolerate at your house? How much television? How much cussing? How much swearing? How much drinking? How much immorality ought you allow? I'm a Christian. How much should I allow? Well, I would think that a Christian ought to get out of the sinning business. And I know you're safe. Well, Brother Green, we're not perfect. I know it. But on the other hand, you don't have to practice sin. You're not perfect, that's true. But on the other hand, you don't have to deliberately plan or allow sin to be in your life. It doesn't seem sensible. In fact, the matter is, Peter tells us in chapter 4 and verse 1 of 1 Peter, cease from sin. Cease, I mean stop. Get out of the sin business. Let me quote it again. If you don't hate sin, you're not through with it. There's another lesson in our lesson, and that is about those gates. Don't be a show-off. Don't try to make some impression of how smart you are, how rich you are, or how great you are, or how good-looking you are, or maybe how strong you are. We had a fellow come to our school. He doesn't come now. This was 6-7 years ago. Come in from another school. And he couldn't match mine. And he couldn't match his abilities with the other kids in our school. I mean, you know, athletically or any otherwise. So he told of how that in the other school, that he was the fastest runner, that he made 40 points a game in basketball, and just all this kind of hoopla, you know. But really, he couldn't hit a basket 10 foot away. He's just full of hot air and windsaw. There are people like that, you know, and brag about what he really couldn't do. You know, Christian people are supposed to be humble people. And I don't know whether or not you were working on it or not, but John the Baptist said, he must increase, I must decrease. So I ask you tonight, how are you getting along with your decreasing? Not your increasing, but your decreasing. Don't be a show-off. Nobody really likes show-offs. Nobody really likes braggers. Ever been around a blowhard? Always shooting his mouth. I could do this. And it's just wall-to-wall mouth. That does not go over good. It's really sickening. And it just makes a fool out of you. I'm talking to Christian workers now. You don't have to brag.